Nobody knew what was coming or quite how to feel about it.
How still this quiet cornfield is tonight. By an intenser glow the evening falls, bringing not darkness but a deeper light. Among the stooks, a partridge covey calls. These homes, this valley spread below me here, the rooks, the tilted stacks, the beasts in pen, have been the heartfelt things past speaking dear to unknown generations of dead men, who, century after century, held these farms and, looking out to watch the changing sky, heard, as we hear, the rumours and alarms of war at hand and danger pressing nigh.
An idyll under threat, August 1914, a summer captured in its idealised pastoral loveliness by writers, artists and musicians. Vaughan Williams composed The Lark Ascending that summer, although the piece wouldn't be performed until 1920. John Masefield wrote the elegy, August 1914, his last poem until the end of the war. Both he and Vaughan Williams, though too old to fight, would go on to volunteer as medical auxiliaries. For the cultural establishment, it was a moment of fragility, a time to cherish and defend the values and places held dear. But then such anxiety wasn't new. For years there had been creeping unease that Britain, and in particular England's very fabric, was under threat.
The Riddle of the Sands, Erskine Childers, 1903. It seems a wild scheme, I observed. Wild, in a way. So is any invasion. But it's thorough. It's German. No other country could do it. It's all dawning on me. By Jove!
Danger. Conan Doyle, July 1914, Strand Magazine. It is an amazing thing that the English, who have the reputation of being a practical nation, never saw the danger to which they were exposed.
There'd been a number of invasion scares over the course of the mid-19th century.
Historian Dr. Katrina Pennell, author of A Kingdom United.
Between 1870 and I would say about sort of 1909, 1910, you see a flood of invasion literature that characterises Germany as the potential enemy, both the enemy without, so potentially invading the UK, or the enemy within. There are famous invasion stories where the German enemy comes out of factories. They've been working as illegal immigrants, if you like, to use a modern day term.
National anxiety might find a metaphor in fantasies of espionage and invasion, but its roots were more complex. Concerns over home rule in Ireland, the rise of industrial unionism, and the activism of the suffragettes all chipped away at the apparent solidity of the political and economic establishment, adding domestic worries to historic preoccupations with Germany, or more specifically Prussia. Then at the beginning of August 1914, those disparate doubts became one certainty.
Once war is declared, once Britain makes that commitment to its allies, France and Belgium, on the whole, writers, artists, musicians rally around the national cause, and many of them are too old to enlist, so this is their way of making their sacrifice.
In both Britain and Germany, there was an immediate flood of verse, professional and amateur, to newspapers, the most social media of 1914. In the Times and other British papers, the sentiment was robust, even bombastic. In defence of tradition, rhetoric drew on the glorious past and its glorious military victories.
The Vigil, by Henry Newbolt. England, where the sacred flame burns before the inmost shrine, where the lips that love thy name consecrate their hopes and thine, where the banners of thy dead weave their shadows overhead, watch beside thine arms tonight. Pray that God defend the right.
At this early stage, there's little to suggest the raw realism of verse now associated with the conflict. The poetry of the trenches will come later. It would also be categorised as a more literate war, volunteers from educated classes joining the traditional infantry. If war had been vaguely and uneasily anticipated for some years, its actual arrival was almost welcomed by those who sensed a fatal dwindling of British vigour. The poet and essayist Edmund Gosse wasn't the only proponent of a startling theory that war might, in some ways, be cleansing, even reviving.
War is the great scavenger of thought. It is the sovereign disinfectant, and its red stream of blood is the Condy's fluid that cleans out the stagnant pools and clotted channels of the intellect.
Edmund Gosse was above all a Victorian man of letters. He was librarian of the House of Lords, a man who was fond of books and people with titles. He was described by somebody as entering a fashionable party, sniffing the air for duchesses.
Samuel Hines, emeritus professor at Princeton and author of A War Imagined.
He wrote in that article, which he calls War Literature, war is then good for us. A feeling that somehow the war was that world's fault, that we would have to reject it.
Our wish for indulgence of every sort, our laxity of manners, our wretched sensitiveness to personal inconvenience, these are suddenly lifted before us in their true guise as the spectres of national decay. And we have risen from the lethargy of our dilettantism to lay them, before it is too late, by the flashing of the unsheathed sword.
People do say very disturbing things in 1914 about the war when they don't entirely appreciate what this war is going to mean.
Exeter University's Tim Kendall, author of Modern English War Poetry.
Wilfred Owen, who's in Bordeaux, having a rather enjoyable time working as a tutor, says the war will effect a little useful weeding. Yeah, Owen grows out of that very quickly. But I think there's a lot of that in the air. And I think even the patriotism and the jingoism of 90% of the poems of the day, they have that moral complacency within them as well.
Read the poems of Rupert Brooke in 1914. The first sonnet he wrote after war was declared, I think it was the first, begins,
"Now God be thanked who has matched us with his hour, and caught our youth, and wakened us from sleeping, with hand made sure, clear eye, and sharpened power, to turn as swimmers into cleanness leaping, glad from a world grown old, and cold, and weary."
What kind of a description of entering a war is that? Swimmers into cleanness leaping. He didn't know. Wars are unimaginable until you're there.
Some of the things people say about Brooke is that he's naive, he's innocent, he doesn't realise what war is. But in fact, he has seen the war. He signs up in the early days of the war, and we are talking days even rather than weeks. He's present at the siege and the fall of Antwerp.
"I saw what was a truer hell. Thousands of refugees, their goods on barrows and handcarts and perambulators and wagons, moving with infinite slowness out of the night, the old men mostly weeping, the women with hard-drawn faces. The eyes grow clearer, and the heart, but it's a bloody thing. Half the youth of Europe, blown through pain to nothingness in the incessant mechanical slaughter of these modern battles."
And he says, we have to understand that just as this is happening in Belgium today, this could be happening in our country tomorrow. And so those poems of 1914, five sonnets, they really are a rallying cry for the nation to wake up.
"Sing, Belgium, sing, although our wounds may bleed, although our voices break."
Belgium. A million German soldiers marched through the unassuming lowland nation, a modern democracy with a photogenic young king, Albert. Britain had pledged to support Belgian neutrality. The Rape of Belgium provoked fervent response from salons to music hall and an instant hit for Violet Lorraine.
The Belgian government actually decides that it's going to defend its neutrality militarily, which is unexpected. Hence this idea that Belgium has bravely taken a stand on behalf of European civilization.
Sophie de Schipdriver, Belgian historian at Penn State University.
So hence, brave little Belgium. And then, of course, within days, the invasion unfolds and the first massacres of civilians start, the first ones around Liège. And then the image shifts towards heroic and then martyred little Belgium.
The chimes of the carillon, Belgium's national instrument, resounding from the Memorial Tower in Louvain. From the balcony, some 50 metres up, you can see the old university city, what the Times called the Oxford of Belgium, much of it rebuilt since the night of August the 25th, 1914. Then, in retaliation for alleged sniper fire, German forces set fire to the 14th century university hall and its 18th century library wing. In the Allied countries, this act of intimidation was compared to the sack of Rome. Mark Deritz.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.